The Gemara starts off by telling us that Rabbi Loyu, who chopped down a date tree that was a male gender date tree that had inferior dates, and therefore it wouldn't be considered being mafsid pairs of shvias. The Gemara then brings down two brayshes that discuss the cutoff time to eat pairs of shvias. One brayshe says it depends on where each of these pairs are available in different cities. The other brayshe links them to specific dates such as Chanukah, Purim, Sukkot, or Pesach. The Gemara says these brayshes are consistent with each other because it's possible that the time when these certain pairs are depleted in those cities is consistent with the timing that the other brayshe says. The Gemara also says that the brayshe says if you do find any one of these pairs available longer, that would definitely extend your time to be able to eat them. Then Rabbi Shimon Gamliel tells us about four different types of properties and trees that would have to be in those properties to identify those properties as such. And he's talking about mountains, valleys, prairies, and riverbeds, and they each have their own type of plant associated with them. The Nafkamina, the Gemara says, would be Lameka Chamemkar. If I sell you this type of property, it would have to have those trees on them in order to be able to be considered that I sold you the property that we made up with. The Mishnah then continues and tells us about the Halacha, a Behema Gasa. You're not allowed to sell a Behema Gasa to a Goy, because it's a chashash that it could lead to being over on Shvisas Behemtecha. The Mishnah says that this prohibition not only applies to a full-grown Behema Gasa, it applies to Agolim and Siyachim, which are baby animals. There's a Machlokes Tanoim in our Mishnah. If the animal's injured and they can't do work anyway, is there a gzeira there as well to prohibit selling that to a goy? There's also a machlokes tanoim if a horse is allowed to be sold to a goy, because a horse normally only carries people, it couldn't lead to a malacha d'iraisa. So there's a machlokes as to whether or not you're allowed to sell a horse to a goy. As far as the behemah daka is concerned, there are certain places where the minig was to sell a behemah daka to a goy, and there are certain places where the minig was not to sell a behemah daka to a goy, and you stick to the minig. Then the Mishnah discusses, are you allowed to eat roasted meat Pesach by night? So the Mishnah tells us, in the places where the minig was to eat roasted meat, you're allowed to. And in the places where you were not allowed to eat roasted meat on Pesach by night, you're not allowed to. And the reason why you wouldn't be able to eat roasted meat is because it looks like you're eating your Karban Pesach out of Yerushalayim. Rabbi Yehuda Marav tells us that one shouldn't say about a piece of meat, this is for Pesach. Because it sounds like he's saying this is the Karban Pesach, and then it's like he's eating kachim out of the proper place. However, if it's wheat that he's talking about, this wheat is for Pesach, that you're allowed to say, because no one's going to think that you're selling that wheat to buy a Karban Pesach. People will assume that the wheat is for your matzahs. The Gemara challenged this from a story that Rabbi Yossi brought down from Tutus. Tutus in Rome made a minhag for everybody that they should roast the full gedi every Pesach by night, as if it's the Karban Pesach, which really looks like kachim b'chutz. And the Rabbanim told him, if it wasn't for the fact that you were such a powerful person, we would put you in cheirim for this, because you're making someone do things that looks like they're doing kachim b'chutz. The problem is the only problem they had was the fact that the whole gedi was roasted as one unit, which is just like the Karban Pesach, but just a piece of meat, it doesn't seem like they would have had a problem with. So why does Rabbi Marav say you're not even allowed to say about a piece of meat that this is for Pesach? The Gemara answers, Tudus' problem was, even if he didn't say this is for Pesach, you just roasted it that way, they objected to it. But roasting a piece of meat wouldn't be a problem. It's only a problem, according to Rav, if you actually say this is for Pesach, that's where it's a problem. The Gemara thought, brought down from somebody who quoted the story of Tudus in the name of Rabbi Shimon. But the Gemara said that has to be a mistake, because Rabbi Shimon wouldn't have had a problem. According to Rabbi Shimon, there wouldn't have been a problem with what Tudus did, because Rabbi Shimon holds that when you say something that's impossible, it doesn't work. So if I say this is a Karban Pesach, but it can't be a Karban Pesach because it's already shechted, so no matter what I did with this animal, if I'm roasting an animal Pesach by night, even if I said this is a Karban Pesach, it wouldn't be able to be a Karban Pesach. And therefore, there wouldn't be any concern that it looks like you're eating your Karban Pesach out of the proper place. The Gemara asks, this Tudus, he was a very powerful person. Was he powerful because he was a tough person and they were afraid to start up with him? Or was he powerful because he was a Talmud Chacham and that's why they didn't want to put him into Chayim? The Gemara says, in fact, he was a Talmud Chacham, because it quoted another beautiful vort that he said over. And he asked, why did Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, why did they risk their lives, or they sacrificed their lives, L'shem Shemayim, L'shem Kiddushim Shemayim, Where did they see that from? And he said that he saw that they saw it from the Tzvardeya. The Tzvardeya in Mitzrayim jumped into the ovens in the Makas Tzvardeya. They didn't have to, yet they jumped into the ovens and they sacrificed their lives. So the Chananiya Mishael Vazara said, if these animals who have no mitzvah of Kiddushim Shemayim sacrificed their lives, we should also. The Gemara also tells us that Tudus was a very special person because he would invest money with Talmid Chachamim to help them make Parnasa, and that's why he was considered a very chash of a person. The next Mishnah talks about whether or not you're supposed to light candles, Yom Kippur, in your home. So the Mishnah says where there's a minik to light candles, you do. Where there's a minik not to light candles in your home, you don't. But everybody agrees you light candles in the Beis Medrash and you light up darkened streets because it's supposed to be bright on Yom Kippur. The Gemara tells us the question as to whether or not you should light candles in your house for Yom Kippur is actually both sides are trying to accomplish the same thing. We're trying to discourage people from being over on the Inu of Tashmish HaMitah. And one side thought that if it's light, people would avoid it. The other side thought that if it's light, it might induce it. And that's why they were both really trying to accomplish the same thing, which the Gemara says about them. Rava says, Va'amech kulam tzadikim. Everyone's a tzaddik, they just have different approaches of how to acquire the same goal of being careful with the inuyim of Yom Kippur. Then the Gemara discusses the fact that we make a boyer moyer eish every Motzei Shabbos. The Gemara quotes from Rabbi Yochanan that we only make a boyer moyer eish on Motzei Shabbos, not on Motzei Yom Kippur. The Gemara tells us a story of a ula who was riding on a donkey, and on his right was Rabbi Abba, on his left was Rabbi Bar Chana. And Rabbi Abba seemed to indicate to Ula, he told him, I heard over from you in the name of Rabbi Yochanan that Rabbi Yochanan says that you only make a Bayri Ma'ayri Ha'esh, Motzei Shabbos, not Motzei Yom Kippur. Ula turned to Rabbi Bar Chana and gave him a dirty look. Rabbi Abba must have heard it from you. Why would you say that over in my name if it's not true? So Rabbi Bar Chana right away piped up and said, that's not what I said over in the name of Rabbi Yochanan. What I said over in the name of Rabbi Yochanan is if Yom Kippur falls out on Shabbos, even though normally every Friday afternoon we light candles for Shabbos, if it's Yom Kippur, you don't light candles. But I never addressed Motzei Shabbos and Motzei Yom Kippur. And the Gemara says, as a matter of fact, they held that on Motzei Yom Kippur, even according to Rabbi Yochanan, you would light Neiris just like you do on Motzei Shabbos, and you would make the Boirei Ha'esh.